please join me in a warm welcome for Michael Bonner.
I love your little thing behind you, the little model that you have made up behind you. It's so cool. Like if I had one, it would probably be the height of my ceiling, but I think I'm going to order one.
Thank you.
Everybody, welcome, 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 welcome to this amazing conference. I am an individual and a person who do not stand behind people who aren't really about anything or aren't trying to make change happen. And I'm so glad she took the time to sign up for this webinar. Making our children and building them into being phenomenal thought leaders and global citizens is something that this organization believes in. And I know that today you will get all the tools necessary to do so. I am going to share my screen right now because I want to show you really quickly. There we go. I want to take you through this presentation about teaching during uncertain times, and I do not want to waste your time. We're going to have an amazing 20 minutes today. So if you have your phone, if you have your notebook, whatever the case may be, you're more than welcome to take notes about what's going on and what's happening within this presentation. All right. COVID-19 threw all of us off. And I know for me personally, I miss my students. Like, look at those smiles and those faces. This is sixth grade, and I will tell you, I love Colin. Colin is looking at one of her classmates because we were having a huge debate inside of the classroom, and she's looking at him like, you know you're about to lose this battle, right? And the beautiful thing about children and what they've taught me is they can show you a lot of different things that you may not understand firsthand. So they taught me about these here. Have you seen the fidget spinners, everybody? I'm quite sure you've seen them. Talk about how they help with depression and anxiety. And let me tell you something. We all have needed help with depression, anxiety, and so many different things that are going on as COVID has sort of shut us down as human beings and working from home. So I went to the store and I found my own teacher fidget spinner, and I hope that you can pick up one as well. I believe it will help you with your depression, your anxiety, and I think that it will be beneficial in improving your practices, all right? So let's go ahead and move on. I showed people this slide in November of last year. And it is a combination of applications that did not exist in 2007. And I wanted to explain to people that the world is constantly evolving. If you look at most of these companies now, they are billion-dollar companies. I always tell the joke when my sister went off to college to North Carolina Central University, we had to print off our directions from MapQuest. I know you remember that you have to read the directions from MapQuest and pass them on. And then you can just plug inside of an actual app on your phone. But now even as society progresses and our world becomes even more innovative, down to UPS, they have drones that come out of their trucks now to deliver packages to you. And when I look at this content, I look at all the creativity and things that are going on in our society, I begin to ask myself, where are we at inside of the education system? How are we moving? And on today, I wanna show you this picture, but also give you a little bit more details and context so you can look it up a little bit later on how can we not only teach in uncertain times, but why is giving children or having them or molding them into the entrepreneurial mindset is extremely important. Now, here's an important piece of information. You might want to take a picture of this because I researched this past week, okay? Horace Mann, who we all studied inside of college, when you're going to get your education degree, is known as the father of education, okay? He was the individual who sort of started the Board of Education in Massachusetts. And what a lot of people do not know is this. Horace Mann and a couple of educators left the United States and were studying other countries' educational model. And when they were studying other countries' educational model, they went to Prussia, which is now Germany. When they went to Prussia, they decided to implement the Prussian education model inside of the United States. But the problem with the Prussian education model is it was built to sort of feed children one piece of information, to sort of downplay critical thinking, being problem solvers. It was built to sort of push children through the school systems to get them to the working class. And if you can afford more, you will go to the more elite schools and have a more established career. But with the Prussian education model, check out Johann Fichte, who was a philosopher from Germany. And this is what he said about the school systems as he helped influence it. His quote was, "The schools must fashion the person and fashion him in such a way that he cannot simply will otherwise than what you wish him to will." So their education model was built upon how can we help children, not even help children, how can we control children and teach them what we want them to think? And if you ask me, that is why we have the inequities that we do inside of the education system. The American education system isn't broken. The American education system is operating as it was originally designed to operate. So what we're understanding now is we have to change it. We have to have some type of reform towards it, which is why I love how we're establishing the mindset of being an entrepreneur. If you look here, if we try to go through the equality mindset, you will begin to see that everybody is in an equal position, right? And we know that throughout society, with the unfortunate death of George Floyd, with funding to different school systems, to the criminal justice arena, through the legislative arena, with redlining, with voting, voter suppression, our society isn't necessarily built equally. So now we're moving to equity. And this is a huge term inside of education. But I need people to understand, as a person who understands business, when you have more money, you have more options. And the unique thing about equity is that you need money to provide those resources. And people who have more money will always find a way to get what they need. But when you transition a little bit more, I try to tell people I'm approaching education now from the concept of liberation. What do you mean by liberation, Mr. Bonner? Obviously, if the education system was not built for everybody to succeed, that is why we're at right now, which means we have to tear down certain walls and things, maybe standardized assessment. It may be the makeup of the classroom size inside the classroom, funding for teachers, teacher pay. You have to begin to break down those things to figure out how can we make sure students are thriving in our education system. And I knew when I was talking about this in November that all it took was one major thing to happen. And before we know it, here come COVID-19, a global pandemic that nobody could have ever predicted, that completely wrecked our entire society and made us sit back and think, what can we do to shift? Now, oftentimes what people fail to recognize is when problems happen, we begin to become negative. We begin to become pessimistic. We begin to look and say, oh my gosh, what's happening? We can't grow any further. But I want to tell you, maybe unfortunate events of COVID-19, even though people have died from it, and God have mercy, I'm praying for those that have been affected by it and family members affected by it here in the chat. But maybe this is also a chance for us to fix something that was already wrong. COVID-19 did not create inequities. COVID-19 exposed the inequities that were already inside of our society and our school system. But we have a chance to fix that. And innovative people like yourself can do that. We can take Jeff Bezos, for example, the CEO of Amazon. Not only did COVID-19 affect every industry and every sector, but check out what Amazon did. They bought Whole Foods not too long ago. They acquired the grocery store chain. What ended up happening was they took certain Whole Foods stores and they shut them down, and now they call them dark stores. So people, so they won't transfer the coronavirus, can go by and they can pick up their groceries instead of going in and shopping. Talking about being innovative on the go. And as educators, we can do the same. In fact, the University of California has already started tearing down the fence and making sure students have a great chance in being successful by dropping the SAT and ACT scores from admissions for the next 4 years. So what we're noticing right now is people are making a step to do so. And I think on this morning and until noon, we're going to be able to figure out how we can also all be better collectively, okay? So what I want to do is I want to show you, for me personally, in these past 3 months, that they've been a little crazy teaching from home. I want to show you in the three areas that I focused in on to make sure that I made my students build the creative skills that they needed, to make sure they were being analytical thinkers, and to also to give them a fighting chance in society as they operate, all right? So the first one I wanna make sure I show you is this, okay? This is the working landing page that I think every person should see. If you're in the chat and you've never seen this before, what this is about 500 CEOs from the top 500 companies met together at a forum, and they sat down and said, hey, what are the top skills that are needed and for when we wanna hire individuals? What skills are we looking for? Elon Musk, Tim Cook, who is the CEO of Apple, have all said that a college degree isn't mandatory to get a job in today's society. I will say it again, in today's society, skills are more valuable than degrees, okay? Which is why when we went into COVID-19, I said, you know what? We don't have to teach any new content right now. We don't have any assessments to worry about, you know, trying to make sure kids are ready for the test and prep them behind the test. I'm going to teach my children at the time of my life and try to build all of these different skills that are shown right here on this diagram, whether it's from critical thinking to people management to emotional intelligence with teaching them how to have empathy to negotiation with business skills. I want to see how could I infuse these different skills in my classroom online or whether we go back in person inside of the fall, right? So the first one I want to focus on is number one, to be sure, is student relationships. And I believe this quote when I say that any decision made without feedback from students is bound to fail. Oftentimes in society, we listen to people and we want them to talk to us about, hey, well, this is what children need. You have researchers coming in with their quantitative and qualitative studies, but when do we ever ask children, hey, how do you like to learn? What are you interested in? And I work from this quote that I live personally by, that you can't demand a withdrawal from someone you have never invested in. It's the facts of the matter. Relationships is the cornerstone of not only just entrepreneurship with social capital, it's the lifeline, the oxygen of how we move and breathe in everyday society. And I want to show you something because I'm the type of teacher, everybody, that I'll try to learn from everywhere, not just inside of a school setting. Now, right here, what you see on this screen is the S&P 500 chart from the stock market. The S&P 500 is the top 500 companies in the United States, or more importantly, in the world, okay? Now, with this, with the stock market, as you can notice, it goes up and down, but you can definitely pinpoint by looking at this graph when COVID-19 hit. And as you can see, it's right after February. Now, to teach you something, when you're an investor and you're extremely wealthy, you never really invest when the stock market is doing really good. You really go in and buy more stocks and shares when things crash, when things are going bad, when things are going terrible, when people are fearful, right? That is the best time for an investor to invest inside a particular business or individual or organization. Now, with all the things that were going on inside of our classrooms, inside of our school systems, inside of our student lives, they had moments this year where things crashed. You had COVID-19, which took kids out of the school systems where they could have their own meal. You had the school year cut short, so people can even have their own graduation. They had to have a drive-through graduation, unfortunately. You also had the death of George Floyd, the murder of George Floyd, which affected our entire society, that the whole entire world is protesting to make sure that people understand the concept of Black Lives Matter. Now, while all this societal change and things are happening in regards to student relationships, the question I want to ask you today is, have you attempted to engage in a meaningful conversation with your students during the societal crash? If we want to instill a entrepreneurial mindset, and if we want to make sure that we get students to do something or to complete a project or to learn or to love the process of learning, when have you invested into them? And if you ask me, now was the perfect time to do so. Because as a classroom teacher right now, that's not just presenting you theories, let me explain something to you and I'll be transparent, show you the next slide. Our students are talking about it. What you see on the screen right now are text messages from my students. And I'll give you 30 seconds to scan them as quick as possible. They know what's going on. When we were growing up, if you had a TV, if you had access to the newspaper, possibly. But now our students see it right there on their phone. So as an educator, I challenge you on today, as we're trying to make sure that we're loving our students and giving them the best thing possible, the best thing that you can do are these two things. Number one, teachers should attempt to love your students with all your heart, mind, and soul, regardless of their race, regardless of their sexual orientation, regardless of their financial background. This should be the very first thing you should do. And secondly, our job as educators, whether you're inside of administration or leadership or whatever the case may be, is that you should be willing to remove any form of ignorance from within your circle, your classroom, or your environment. Having those proper relationships will allow us to do that, and it will help you to do that as well. In fact, there's a student in my class who wrote a phenomenal expose, and she was just basically talking to Mr. Bonner about everything that's going on, about the educational revolution, about how we need more representation, and she was essentially venting, which is why her name would not be shown. So as a teacher, what I decided to do, oh, COVID-19, I can't get to her, I can't hug her, I can't help with her frustration. What you see on the right is a logo, because I told her, sweetheart, the way that you talk, and you're such a great orator, your ideas are phenomenal. What I wanna do is, let's build you a podcast. I need you to make me a logo for your podcast, and I will set it up through Anchor FM. And as you can see on the right-hand side, she built her company, which is called T-Rex, and it's a play upon words, because if you know children, they say, what's the T, which means what's the gossip? And she created T-Rex, right? But it's an outstanding way of putting students in the position of taking hurt and pain and current events and letting them mold themselves into being even better students and leaders in the future, okay? Now, actionable steps. I wanna make sure you understand this, because I've been doing this research and stuff myself in regards to building better student relationships so I could identify with them. The best work that you can do ever as an educator is internal work on yourself. And this book right here has completely exposed Mr. Bonner to his own biases, to his own privileges. It is an actual book written for teenagers, but it reads really, really well. And I know that if you pick up this book, it will help you tremendously in regards to understanding how to relate better to your students, okay? The next one, if you have not reached out to your kids, okay, I need you to make sure that you do that, whether it's through a phone call, whether it's through an email, whether it's through a social media message. People, after COVID, well, during COVID-19, after I teach class, I would literally play Fortnite, Call of Duty, and Roblox with my students for at least an hour on Zoom, finding ways to connect with them. And that way, I can figure out how can I better service them to either build their own businesses or to make sure they're becoming phenomenal leaders, okay? Let's go to the next one, culturally responsive teaching. The reason why this is a term that's not only, it has erupted right now with Black Lives Matter movement that's happening, but this is something that has been studied for a while. And I think for every person here on the line, we need to understand that our student population is more diverse than it has ever been. And with culturally responsive teaching, the teacher focuses their content, their literature, their approach, their classroom management around everybody's personality within the classroom, coach within the classroom. And that is how you keep them engaged and build phenomenal entrepreneurs. And that is how you keep them engaged and make them students of life, lifelong learners, okay? So this is a picture of my sixth grade crew. They challenged me. I have never taught sixth grade reading before. I teach at the Ron Clark Academy, which is a nonprofit, everybody. So we work off of the foundations and the donations of individuals who come to our school to support our students. And then we have visitation days. So not only did I teach a grade that I wasn't used to teaching, but I had teachers watching me teach a grade that I wasn't used to teaching yet. And what it did was it put me in a position of understanding what is the most important thing they need, especially when your school year gets cut off, all right? So here are three things I want to give you today as educators or as an administrator or whatever your role may be, that you can make sure students are engaged, all right? Because we noticed that standards were sort of put to the side, assessments were put to the side. So how can we make sure that our students are learning? And I believe through these three different keys right here, okay? The first one is using current events. It is so dynamic, it is so powerful, and I believe all of us should use current events to make sure that our students are informed about society and things that are going around us, right? But if you look at this right here, this was a teacher that I know, that was inside of a group, and she talked about how she wants to address the current events and things that are happening, but the district is telling them not to. And I wanna form this question to you from a professional opinion of, if you don't talk about the issues, what does that reinforce? That's the bigger question that we must begin to understand. If we want our students to be problem solvers, analytical thinkers, people that can think critically on the fly, that can solve issues in every community, in every situation, we sort of have to put them in a position to talk about things that are happening currently right now. So if you want to try this, it's very simple. Here is a website, and I have the QR code here. This website is called All Sides, and I didn't know about it, but as a teacher who uses Newzella, which is a great resource to teach news information, what I want to make sure I show you is that this website shows you, based upon the news article and news station, where they fall in regards to their beliefs, whether they're far left, okay, or whether they're far right, all right? And when you go to this website, it will give you all the different news articles and things you can check out. In fact, if you're looking up a specific article, it can let you pick an article from each category so your students can see the different viewpoints and begin to have proper discourse about it. And this was given to me by my school counselor, Electra Thompson, who is absolutely amazing in social emotional learning and mental health for students and teenagers. And I think this is critical as we begin to push forward because our students, once again, are paying attention. Now, as right now, as we talked about, the current event is Black Lives Matter movement, which is happening. People are rioting, they're frustrated. And on the right, I have the skills that I wanted to show you. If you're a teacher, trust me, you can take a current event and make it into something absolutely amazing for all your students from every category, whether it's in leadership, having students organize potential policies or financial things. I have my students determine how much we want to donate to different organizations. You can use science. Protesters in China developed a solution that can put out tear gas so they can protest peacefully. You can do art, students developing a poem or spoken word, mathematics, figuring out the demographics of individuals at the protest. Putting them in a position to learn from every different content area with one current event is possible and it can be done, okay? It can be done. Just have fun with innovating and figuring out what do your students necessarily need, all right? The next one is creating space for discourse. There's a difference. I learned this from Brandon Fleming, who established the Harvard Diversity Project. Discourse is when you're trying to win somebody to your side. Debate is when you're trying to compete against someone and actually defeat them. And in my classroom, sometimes we do debates, but I enjoy discourse more because it puts my students in a position to hear everybody's thoughts, to figure out different solutions. The wealthiest people in society right now, the millionaires and billionaires, are people who found a solution to a worldwide problem. And our students can do that regardless of their race, sexual orientation, or whatever background that they come from, right? So right here is a powerful protest. There's about 10,000 people here. And when I saw this picture, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. I can't believe these people. I mean, look at the diversity in age, in regards to ethnicity, in regards to race. I mean, this is powerful. And would you believe that this protest in Nashville, Tennessee, were organized by these five beautiful queens, students, aged from the ages of 14 to 16. And that's why I try to explain to teachers now that there are students who are speaking up before educational communities and before educators, and they're taking charge. In fact, these five beautiful young ladies told the news channel that they were born in the digital age and we can do anything. Imagine a student having that mindset and meeting a teacher who has the same mindset and showing them how can they take their passion, their gifts, and bring it into fruition. How can they help the better good? And I think we can make all of our students, or actually show them how to do the same thing. Entrepreneurship, if you ask me, is about having a voice and creating a product so that the world can actually glean from it and it helps serve the world. And our students are prepared to do that. Here's a way that you can do it in your classroom to have proper discourse is by using Flipgrid. If you don't know about Flipgrid, very simple application. Flipgrid allows you to post a question, a video, or statement, and the students can respond individually with videos. So right now, if I wanted to create, if you want to do something fun, this is off the top of my head, let's have fun with this. You want to do it with your students? This is what you can say. You can put the question inside of the Flipgrid and say, hey kids, should we return back to school in the fall? Some people have said we need to have a hybrid model where students learn from home for 3 days and go to school for 2 days, or should we just let everybody go back to school? Present the question to them and allow them to share their thoughts based on facts. And that is how you get the flow of conversation to have in your classroom. That is how you change the environment with your students from you just being direct instruction to you becoming a facilitator and teaching them how to critically think on their own. That is what we want and that is what we need in today's society, all right? The last one is dynamic read alouds. Literature is extremely important, especially when it comes down to solving different types of information or different types of problems inside of society. Literature and books has a way of taking us from here into another world. There is this beautiful lady, her name is Emerita Rudine Sims Bishop. She's a professor, and I believe at Ohio State University. I forgot to include that down there. You've probably heard her quote before. And her quote says this, children need books that are mirrors that allow them to see themselves and their own experiences, windows that they can look through to see other worlds they can compare to their own, and sliding glass doors that allow them to enter other worlds, right? Perfect. What she's saying is she's laying her stake in saying that literature is the perfect way to allow us to expose children to different situations, different circumstances, different races, different cultures, different scenarios, different situations. It puts our children in a position to expand their thinking. And that is what we need. And you can do that yourself, not only just through Epic Books, but getting a read aloud and popping in front of a camera and reading. I read this book, in fact, right here, we're planning to talk about this, Dear Justice. To my students, which is coming out in October, written by the amazing Nick Stone. And I read that out loud to my students during the COVID-19, and they were engaged throughout the entire read aloud, all right? So I wanna show you really quickly why literature is important, because we've noticed a trend with representation in books. And if you look at the research that was done in 2012, and I'll show you three different slides, you can see that representation in the books in regards to the protagonist, the character that is saving the day or the good character, it wasn't that diverse. And as you can look through 2015, it starts to get a little bit better, okay? In 2018, it becomes get a little bit better. And that is what we want. I want my students to study people who look like them and who do not look like them. Why? So they became able to solve a problem anywhere in society. Right now in our current education system, we have some teachers or individuals or systems that are teaching children to only solve problems with only in their community. And that's great, but we need to push them to think globally. And that is how we can expand them to build a phenomenal product when they decide to take their passion and turn it into an actual business, okay? Now, for those of you here, I wanna help you out with this because I know when people say books, literature matter, the next question is, well, Mr. Bonner, what books can I pick up? And I have some things for you, okay? All of us are reading teachers, even though we may teach reading from different contexts or using different types of texts, okay? Social studies, you may use a newspaper, you may use a primary source. Math, you may be using a word problem. Science, maybe using some type of quick paragraph explaining a certain type of chemical, but all of us are reading teachers, and I wanna give you a couple of books. This lady name is Jane Mount. I've already messaged her. She allowed me to use her illustrations in the next two slides. You can follow her on social media. She's an artist, but she also loves books, so she created her business this way, and she drew books that teachers could use, all right, inside of classrooms. So right here are books for babies from infants all the way up to the age of 13. And I'll hold it here for about 10, 15 seconds so you can check it out. And you can either screenshot it or take a picture with your phone. But as you can see, all these different books deal with the current issues that are happening right now. She does different drawings of books that come from all different types of situations and problems, but this is good starting ground for all of you. In fact, Mr. Bonner, I'm going to start with Stamp myself with my students, and I'm also going to start with Trevor Noah possibly within the next year. Now, for those that are 13 up, for my middle school and high school teachers, I got you covered too, even for college as well. Here's a book for a book ages 13 and up that students can cover. Nick Stone wrote Dear Martin, which is in the middle here. The book was so powerful that they actually abandoned in some counties, but they actually reversed that because the book told such a powerful story. But you have two pictures here, excuse me, that will show you the dynamic that you will need, all right? And you can also use that through Flipgrid, reading the book and stuff out loud, having students discuss the book out loud. For those of you who do not have technology, if Mr. Bonner did not have access to technology to teach my kids, this is what I would do. I would literally start me a YouTube channel. I will grab my cell phone. I will record myself reading a book out loud, and I will send that out to my students, whether through Facebook, to their parents, to their cell phone, and ask them any questions. I would literally make myself reading Rainbow to ensure that students are still learning and having fun with the content and things that are going on, and then asking them to produce a product outside of a worksheet. Ask them to think about how they can create a song or a policy or a painting or a drawing of something. And I did that with my kids. This is something I call a character analysis, which is really quick. Obviously, we could not keep grades or grade our students because we weren't necessarily in school, was there to model. So right here, what I'm showing you is a character analysis, and I asked my students to do it on upon themselves. So they drew a picture of themselves. They gave us a song, okay? I'm sorry, let me go back. They gave us a song that describes them, and they listed their inside traits and outside traits. And you can make this even more dynamic for those inside of middle school and high school. You can ask your students to describe a character in a story, and then ask them to list a trait. And then they can actually put a reference to, I'm saying that this character, Mr. Bonner, is a narcissist because of this particular action in this section of the story. This builds their skills, not only in understanding and comprehending, but teach them how to analyze different situations as well, okay? And the last one, in regards to teaching at certain times, this is mandatory, prioritizing the community. Our world has been affected. There is no way around that, okay? It's to the point that we have the highest unemployment since the Great Depression. There are 20.5 million people who are not only infected by the coronavirus, but we had a lot of people who were unemployed. So our families were hurting. And at our school, we are a nonprofit, which means we run off the donations of communities and people around us. At our school, to better connect with our family, because you can't improve the life of a student or help them to recognize their greatness without engaging with their family, we actually set up an email. I think it was the idea of Mr. Lecter Thompson, the school counselor. And within the email, parents could email the school if they needed some type of material, whether it was more food, whether it was resources to money. And what will happen is this will put parents in a position to get connected to resources that we know inside of our community. And I think it's extremely important when we do that, because it allows us to make sure that our parents and our families are getting exactly what they need. All right. Now, this is the end of the keynote, and I'm excited about the breakout sessions because I have my notebook stuff here as well. But what I do want to make sure I share with you is this. On the screen is my cell phone number. It's my business number. And I want to let you know that there isn't a such thing as one great teacher. We're better when we collaborate and stuff together. So if you would like to, just shoot me a text there. I always respond there. There are some people here within the chat that I've been texting with here, today. And I just want to thank you for taking the time to come out and, more importantly, figure out how can we be better, especially teaching at certain times, and how can we push our students to be better with everything that's going on. I appreciate you, and I can't wait for these breakout sessions. Okay. Matthew, I'll turn it back over to you, buddy.
I would like to take some time right now to let some of our attendees today ask you some questions. So if you guys want to jump into the chat with some questions, we'll help Michael monitor the questions. And thank you for the thought-provoking words, the resources that you shared that I know a lot of us will jump into.
As we hop into the chat now, let's do it. Let's go here and see. So which online format? So Christine, thank you so much for asking that question. So to be transparent with you, we started with Facebook Live, going live with our Facebooks. And it was working okay, but we missed the interaction with our students. So we transitioned to Zoom. Now, to all the people here, what I need you to understand is that with Zoom, people were a little frantic about it because it was like, oh my gosh, you know, privacy. But Zoom released an update that allowed people to talk and come into the community inside of their classroom, but you would need a password. So all of our kids had a password for our classrooms. I love the format that our school set up in regards to COVID-19. We taught from 9 o'clock to 12. I teach two different classes, sixth grade and fourth grade. So I taught each class for 30 minutes. And Zoom is amazing. You can have a situation where you can break them out into groups, which we're about to do in a couple of minutes. And it makes it very powerful because you can jump into different conversations and listen to kids. So I am a fan of YouTube. It's not for YouTube, I just read a question, of Zoom for sure. So I would check that out if I were you, okay? Okay. With a student with the podcast Earn Income. So great question. So with Anchor FM, it is a website that you can go to. And with Anchor FM, you will be able to set up a podcast. If it begins to get a lot of listeners and views, it will generate income. And that is when I sit down and have a conversation with her. Okay, sweetheart, your podcast is generating income. How can we make sure we reinvest the funds to continue pushing your podcast, but also scale your podcast to another level so that it can help others? So that is a conversation that we'll have when that time comes. But students can definitely do that. And also for all the teachers here, listen to me. We're not Fortnite. We're not Apex. We're not Call of Duty. You'll be shocked how many kids right now are playing the game right now, but they're not streaming. They're not building their own platform to have their own streaming business. They can get a camera that Mr. Bonner ordered right there on top of my TV for $50 from Amazon. I'll buy the camera if you have a group of students who are serious. And what happens is they can stream themselves playing the video game and have their own esports team and compete inside of different competitions and stuff. It's not that difficult. It's just giving our students the tools needed, all right? I play the video game. My nephew plays the video game. But I bought the camera because I say, why would I do something for free that I can get paid for, right? Our students are already on top of those things. Let's see here. Will we have access to the slides? Yes, I will make sure I send that to you because I want to make sure you get the images of the books and things that I presented to you. And I understand you didn't have a chance to write that down. Christine, I understand that you also have students with special needs. So the publisher of my book, my children's book back there, she is absolutely amazing. Asherica is amazing. And what she's done is she utilized Zoom. And she utilized Zoom to just check in with her students to maintain that schedule because we understand some of our students that have specific needs or possible learning disabilities. And what we can do is we can engage them online with their family right through Zoom and sort of walk through and talk to them through different activities to make sure they have the things needed, okay? Yes, I will show the presentation slides. How do you address, somebody had a question.
Great question about the differences between teaching at a public school and teaching at the Ron Clark Academy and how you address issues of sensitive topics, who requires permission.
Okay, so the difference for me teaching at the Ron Clark Academy, and if I'm honest with you, I know a lot of teachers. And if you look around in your own school building, notice in education a trend. When a teacher decides to do something outside of the norm that benefits children, oftentimes it's suppressed. People don't like it. You're doing too much. You don't have enough funds. And what happened at my previous school, and I thank God for them, and it was a great learning experience, is that for me, everybody, I established a company of Bonnerville so I can fund teachers who are doing great things for students. And what happens is with my company as the CEO and the owner, I can control the company. If I said right now, I want to give $10,000 to a teacher, I can do that. And what happened is I understood I needed a little bit more freedom to continually build my business and teaching at the same time. The difference in teaching at the Ron Clark Academy is that every teacher there is united in pushing education forward. I have become a better teacher by being there. I didn't even have a classroom this year. I had to share a classroom with Ron Clark himself. So imagine sharing a classroom with the founder of the school. Obviously, that's gonna push me to become a better teacher because the person that established the school is teaching right in front of me and we will swap when it's time to do classes. So the best thing that I've enjoyed the most about teaching at RCA is they've given me the freedom as a Black man, a minority business owner, to continually scale my business, but more importantly, do what I love, which is serve children. And I love that we're a nonprofit and all the funds that come to our school go back to student scholarships. So people go to the Facebook page and stuff, they see the trips, they see the coats and things, but that comes from community partners and people that support the mission of the school, okay? I know you said something else. Let's see here. In the public school, as you touched on a bit, we're restricted what we can discuss with our students. How do you suggest we safely discuss important issues without parent complaints? I will find a way to implement it and integrate it inside of your lesson. I would definitely do that. So for example, here's a good example. People, my students were asking Mr. Bonner, well, what's going on with all the rioting and looting? Why is that happening? That's never happened before. Yes, it has. As a social studies teacher, it has happened before. The Boston Tea Party was a huge riot and looting situation to make sure that we were fighting for our freedom and protesting against England to gain our own freedom. So you have to find a way to simply integrated. What happens is sometimes families don't like those issues being discussed because it may affect their own views. But I'm a firm believer that if we can tie it back to a standard or we can tie it back to content that we're already teaching, that's the best way to go. And I always think about if I don't address that, what's the downfall of not teaching my students? I showed you the text messages. Okay.
Last question.
Money through affiliate.
Last go ahead, sweetheart.
Okay. I thought you wanted to say it, so I'll look.
Also,
Roy put it inside of the chat. Everybody can check it out. He put the greatest gaming tournaments in the world. If your students are gaming, tell them they need to form a clan. They'll know exactly what I mean. A clan is a group of students who play the video games together all the time and figure out how they can establish a clan name. And they give them the chance to understand they can enter tournaments, all right? You presented a very engaging approach to teaching during COVID. If we do not return to school in the fall, how do you suggest reimagining teaching to incorporate skills as opposed to only following traditional lesson plans? Okay, so Anderson, great question. For me, what I want to do is, with the slide I showed you, I want to make sure that I become a facilitator online. Now, this is more so for me in fourth grade, all the way up to college. I pray for my teachers that are inside of the primary or the kindergarten through second grade, because I know those students need those manipulatives. But what I would do, honestly, is inside of Zoom, I would do a read aloud. I would show them something interesting. I may teach them a couple of vocabulary words, and then I will allow discussion to happen around the classroom. We forget the greatest learning tool is conversation. Why do you think people love going to the hair salon, to church, and to the barbershops and stuff so much? Because of the conversation that is happening there. So empowering and pushing forth great conversation, and you as a teacher operating as a facilitator and guiding it, is a perfect thing. My students will never know if I'm a Democrat or Republican. It's none of their business. But what they will know is both sides, how to analyze both of them to ensure that they have a chance to be amazing, okay?
Thank you.
And I want to make sure, no problem.